In this episode, two friends take a dive together for what turned out to be the last time. Sea lions are playfully swimming in the little cove, flitting in and out of the kelp beds. The sun is shining and glistening off the calm surface of the Pacific Ocean. It appears to be the perfect day to be in the water. But when Randy Fry dives underwater to search for abalone, he swims right into the path of an enormous great white shark. In a split second, his head is ripped clean off from his body, and his terrified friend makes a dash for the boat as the water turns red around him. Hit like and subscribe. This is Fierce. It was a beautiful Sunday afternoon in 2014. Three friends, Cliff Zimmerman, Red Bartley, and Randy Fry, met for lunch at Carine's Fish Grotto in the center of town at Fort Bragg. Situated along California's coastline in Mendocino County, the three men were eager fishermen and decided to head out for the afternoon on Cliff's boat. By mid-afternoon, they decided to try a spot of abalone diving. Cliff turned the boat back to shore and motored into a sheltered cove at Kaipsilla Rock. Sea lions swam around the boat. Some were lying, sunning themselves on the large semi-submerged rocks. They were 150 feet from shore, and the depth gauge read 15 feet. Although it was a popular fishing spot, the little cove was only accessible by boat. The steep, jagged cliffs cast a dark shadow over the water. No one else was about. They had the cove all to themselves. Once there, the men dropped the anchor by a large boulder. Cliff and Randy pulled on their wetsuits, dive masks, and fins. It was around 4 p.m. on the 15th of August, 2014, when Randy and Cliff entered the water on what was to be their last dive together. They had been friends for more than 30 years. Having met in the construction industry in Sacramento during the 1970s, the two men discovered they had a mutual interest in ocean diving. Randy spent all his spare time on the water, whether that was for sport fishing or diving for abalone. Randy and Cliff hit it off and became great friends, often traveling to the coast together for their diving adventures, sitting on the beach after their dives, drinking beer, and talking until the sun went down. Randy had been described as someone who lived his life carefree. Later in life, he made a career as a lobbyist for the Recreational Fishing Alliance. Fishing and diving were his passions. He loved the sea so much that he had often said to Cliff that if he had to go, then he would want it to be in the water. Unfortunately for Randy, that wish was about to come true as, at 50 years old, he met his premature end. With sea lions in the area, Cliff and Randy spoke to Red about sharks. He was told to keep lookout from the boat. If he was to see sea lions acting erratically or anxiously, then he must let them know straight away. Red was a bit worried when he heard this, but his friends assured him that they had been diving together for more than 30 years in these waters, and nothing was going to happen. Red maintained a lookout as his two friends floated on the surface of the water just yards from the boat. He watched as Randy and Cliff gulped in a lungful of air and submerged below the surface. They scoured the ocean floor for the marine mollusk, abalone, looking for the characteristic oval-shaped shells clinging to the rocks. Situated just 170 miles north of San Francisco, the water off Fort Bragg was frequented by sharks. Northern California has a healthy great white shark population. Conservationists and marine biologists estimate there is a growing number of around 300 individuals, signaling a healthy marine ecosystem off the West Coast. Randy, Cliff, and Red knew that sharks frequented the area, but it didn't deter them from diving. They had been in the water with sharks before, and they had never shown any interest in the divers. It irritated Randy when people warned of the dangers of sharks. He knew the odds of being killed on the way to the beach were hundreds of times greater than actually being taken by a shark. In fact, the odds were so long that only 9 people had been killed by great whites off the Californian coast since records began. But those odds were about to catch up to Randy. Swimming in just 15 feet of water, the two friends could see the bottom of the sea below them as they dived down repeatedly, resurfacing frequently for air. They moved towards the kelp beds, where the long strands of seaweed reached for the surface, swaying with the motion of the sea, a forest of brown and dark green. The two of them floated on the surface. Then Randy said to Cliff, "I've got to get a couple of abs. where are they? To which Cliff replied, they're right below me. Randy took a deep gulp of air and dived down, straight into the path of an incoming predator. Cliff sunk his face underwater and watched his friend. The two of them were just 3 feet apart when Cliff noticed something out of the corner of his eye. Immediately, he thought that it was a boat zooming overhead at tremendous speed. But then he felt the water move around him. He saw a flash of dark gray and an enormous shark fin slice through the water between him and his dive buddy. It was like a submarine coming out of nowhere, barreling in between the two of them. Cliff couldn't believe the size of it, as he estimated it to be around 18 feet long and built like a pickup truck. With such speed and power, the two men didn't have time to react. It swooped past Cliff, its eyes fixated on his friend, not much more than an arm's length away. Cliff felt the rough sandpapery skin brush him as it torpedoed past. Time seemed to stand still. His heart thumped hard at the realization of what this enormous gray body was. His eyes opened wide, and within a second, the great white shark had powered into the unsuspecting Randy. He may not have even seen it, as he was looking down at the seafloor at the time. He would have felt an immense smack from behind him, like being hit by a truck. As quickly as it appeared, it closed its powerful jaws around Randy's neck, thrashed its head from side to side, and yanked Randy's head clean off from his body. Cliff screamed underwater as the nightmare unfolded right before his eyes. Cliff was terrified that the shark would turn on him. He didn't dare look back. He didn't dare dip his mask below the surface to see if it was coming for him. Instead, he swam as hard as he could toward the boat. He headed for the little platform at the stern of the boat and yelled at Reb to grab him and pull him as hard as he could. He didn't want to be the guy who nearly made it. Reb grabbed him and hauled him on board. Cliff lay on the floor of the boat for a few seconds, gasping for air, panting hard, completely shocked by what he had seen. Then he and Red peered back over the side of the boat. It was evident from the amount of blood surrounding the scene of the attack that their friend Randy was gone. Red then grabbed the radio. He squeezed the button and relayed his distress Mayday message to the Coast Guard. Within minutes, 3 helicopters were hovering above the cove, and the Coast Guard boat was motoring to the scene. A search for Randy's body began. Their friend was dead within seconds. There was no chance of survival, and the two friends knew it, but they needed to find his body. It wasn't until the next day that Randy's body was recovered from the water. The shark hadn't eaten him. It had likely mistaken him for a seal and swam away after making the fatal blow. Randy's head washed ashore 3 weeks later, discovered by a beachcomber. It was a gruesome and terrifying incident, which left his friends and family devastated and shocked. His death was incredibly quick, and he likely had no idea what was happening when the shark struck him. Randy was cremated, and a memorial service was held on board 2 fishing boats. Out in the sea, the place where Randy felt most comfortable, his ashes were scattered. His final resting place.